Rumors are true, listeners. If you'd like to add me on Instagram and Facebook, it is at the Rumors Are True Cast. If you'd like to like and subscribe, feel free. You know what to do. If not, no matter what, I really appreciate you listening. So, again, if you'd like to add me, you know the drill. If you'd like to subscribe, you know it even better. Thank you, guys.
Welcome, it's Jeremy Allen Gould. I'm coming to you today to confirm between God and of man that in fact, the rumors that you have all heard are true. I started this podcast because I freaking love music. I was privileged enough to book amazing artists and bands in the past, and I was lucky enough to stay in touch with many of them to this day. This is a place to hear their stories. Thank you so much for riding along on this journey, and I hope you enjoy what you hear. With that said, the rumors are definitely true.
Welcome back to this latest episode of the Rumors Are True podcast. My name is Jeremy, and today I welcome Jordan and Joseph Powers. You know Jordan and Joseph from the band Far Less, Ball, Of Sinking Ships, House of Fools, and about a million other bands. Really cool conversation with these guys. I've known them for a while when I booked them back in the day, so it's cool to reconnect and talk about the past, the present, and the future. Hope you enjoy this two-part episode with Jordan and Joseph Powers. Joseph and Jordan, thank you so much for coming on my podcast, guys. Thank you.
Hey, Jeremy. What's up, man?
What's up? How are you guys?
Doing well.
Doing well.
How are you?
Yeah. Joseph, how are you?
I'm doing great. I'm so excited to see you.
Oh, I know. It's been a while.
I'm also excited to see you, Jordan, but... I'm more excited
Aww.
To see
you. Aww. That's really nice of you guys. What do you guys got going on lately? Tell me what's going on, Jordan. What's going on in your life?
Well, I live in Greensboro, North Carolina. Married, two dogs. Still playing music pretty full time. I play in a party band called The Fins, and we play about every weekend. And I work during the day with adults with intellectual and developmental disabilities at a place called the Enrichment Center in Winston-Salem, about 30 minutes up the road from where I live. And we learn music and life skills and get out in the community and play for other people and stuff. So it's pretty fun. But just really kind of being married and whatever that life looks like.
Yeah, man, that's awesome. That's exciting. I love hearing that. I mean, I think that's kind of the goal for most of us, at least, you know, just to have the stability and the job and the wife or the spouse, whoever at home. And that's awesome. That sounds exciting, man. Joseph, what is up, my friend?
Yeah. So about a year and a half ago, I moved back to Charlotte, North Carolina, which was the first spot my wife and I moved to after college. After I left the band and went to back to Virginia Tech, we moved to Charlotte, then to Florida, then to Asheville, then Virginia for a year, and now back to Charlotte, where super happy. We have a four-year-old. She's amazing. And I work as a project manager in the design field, in the design industry, product design, branding, at a pretty cool firm uptown Charlotte. And hadn't played music for a hot minute, but since I moved back to Charlotte, obviously know a bunch of people here from playing shows over the years and from living here previously. And I didn't get asked to join a band, but per se, but the previous and the original bass player was leaving and he threw my name in the hat. And I started chatting with their guitarist Chad, and just kind of jammed, and I don't know that there were any other names in the hat, and I just practiced with them, and then the rest is history, I guess. Awesome. Short history for me anyway. The band's called Up Sinking Ships, and
yeah,
they're kind of a Charlotte instrumental band, been around for a while, and I've played a couple shows now. We got another one coming up, and it's extremely cathartic and fun.
I bet. Yeah, great band. Chad's awesome.
You guys are awesome. You guys are great. We guess I failed to mention I also have an original band called Bow, and we recently did a couple of shows with Up Sinking Ships and the mighty Up Sinking Ships.
That's so cool. How was that playing together? Like playing together, but not. I mean, what's that like?
I loved it so much. It was. I mentioned it on stage. It was the first time that I have ever shared a stage with Joseph that I can remember that we weren't playing on the same stage. I don't know that I've ever seen Joseph at a gig that I was playing, playing in a different band. So yeah, it was great. It was really special. It was a nice weekend. We had really two really cool shows, one in Greensboro and one in Charlotte. And yeah, it was awesome seeing them both nights.
That's cool. Really cool. Justin, what was that like for you?
It's cool because it's a different perspective for me. It was amazing to start with, but so my history is that I've never played a show without Jordan being on stage, but I have seen him play a million shows without me. You know, his his first band in high school I saw play. I loved them. I was like 14, 15, but then I ended up joining that band and we played together a lot. And then after I left Far Less, I saw him play in Far Less without me. And then he joined House of Fools. I saw them a million times. Other bands. He used to play, you know, just fun gigs at bars, and I would always go sing along and hang out. But then it just became this decade of watching him play with me, just like forgetting how to play bass, I guess. And it was great because we were just buddies at a show with our own crew, our own people, but we all kind of knew each other. And it was interesting because some of the guys in Bal and Up Sinking Ships hadn't seen each other recently, but we got in the same room or like knew each other from like a decade before from other bands.
That's so cool. I love that.
Community.
Yeah, it was.
That's how it was nice. Obviously.
Yeah. That's awesome. We'll hopefully get to do more of that. That's cool. That sounds like a, not only a fun time, but just a good time to just reconnect and, you know, just, I don't know. That's what, you know, live music in general is already invigorating, but then you throw all that other stuff in, it just makes it even more special. So that's awesome.
And it doesn't mean I don't ever want to play on stage with Jordan again, but it just means I know how to do it without him.
You've made it, buddy. You've made it. You done good.
You done good. Awesome.
So let's talk about when I met you guys for the first time. We were talking earlier, I think it was 2006-ish in that range. I wound up booking you guys. I thought it was a solo tour of you guys. It was probably one of your first tours, maybe. I don't know. At least, you know, when you were on Tooth & Nail, at least. I booked you guys at the Eagles Lodge in Wichita, Kansas. I specifically remember booking it because I had booked Under Oath the week before, and I was like, this is the same crowd. It's going to be another 1,000 people show up. You know that. Definitely 1,000 people did not show up, but I do remember it vividly in the fact that I remember connecting with you guys, and it was awesome. You guys were so sweet and kind, and I always thought the band was great. So it was just for me, it was cool to book you guys and put you guys at least have a good show for you guys in the area.
Do you happen to remember who else played?
To be honest with you, I think it was just locals, if I had to remember correctly. And I might have had there's a band from there called A Band in Kansas that got kind of big. I think they might have played, to be honest with you. I don't.
Yeah, that name is familiar, and I feel like we may have played with them. Joseph, do you think it would have been around the same time we would have been touring and Shane Birch would have booked some shows? Also in
so you know that little run we did in the Midwest when we were up in what it was at Illinois with Shane and his band and rolling around there, but some of the shows were with bands we were buddies with, but some were one-offs. And I was just gonna say your description of that is just like
a one-off.
Perfect example of what being in Far Less was like. It was like expectations, because we were on Tooth & Nail, were always, you know, high or especially early days when we first released, you know, the first full length and stuff. And we always thought things would be a little more in bigger crowds and stuff. And but we always rolled with it, and we always had the most fun we could in whatever, you know, whatever venue, and develop relationships with friends like you along the way, whether it's just us playing with a bunch of people we don't know, or having being on a tour, or with just one band we're friends with. But yeah, I mean, I think that was right around when we were, you know, 2006 is that's everyone is out to get us. So it could have been right before that album came out. We were playing a little bit of the heavier stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't think that's when we were touring with Paulson yet, but I know we did.
No, someday. It wasn't with Paulson. I did wind up booking Paulson, but I know it was you guys individual. I think, like you said, it might have just been a one-off, like a filler date for you guys in between. And then also too, like Joseph, you wound up living near me, which was really cool. And you were talking earlier about how you and I kind of linked up down in Jacksonville. We're both at the same show randomly. It's okay. Mine does it all the time. I get it. But yeah, so we're at Jackrabbits seeing, Chris Carrabba's band Twin Forks.
My buddy Ethan was on tour with a band from Charlotte called Matrimony, and I was living close to Jacksonville. And here, Jordan, I muted you. I'll unmute you now. Yeah, so Ethan's a great friend of mine, and Ethan is actually previously, when I talked about Upsinking Ships, he's the original bass player for Upsinking Ships. So he's just worked with the Guitar Center. I knew him from bands over the years, and a couple different times he toured through Florida and different groups, and I would go hang out. And yeah, I just remember we were kind of hanging outside Jackrabbits either before or after the show with Chris and all the band members, and you were there, and we kept kind of like catching each other's attention, and I'm like, I recognized you, you recognized me, and then we just put two and two together. We were acquaintances and we became friends, and
yeah, you know, so absolutely,
that's what life's all about.
Yeah, absolutely, man.
I remember.
That's what the music industry is all about. Sorry, Jordan, what?
Oh, I just remember when you guys were hanging out quite a bit in Florida, seeing like on Instagram and Facebook and stuff, you guys were posting, hanging out together.
Yeah,
and I was cool. Always jealous.
Aw. Well, you could have moved down.
Yeah, I could have.
Nobody stopped you.
You're right.
No Florida jokes allowed.
Right. All right, guys. So let's talk about growing up for you guys, and we'll just go individually, obviously, maybe some bands, some records, some influences that kind of put you guys on the path musically, I guess, and just in terms of life in general, you know, that maybe you're looking back on that you can think of. Well, we can start with you, Joseph. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say we'll start with Jordan because he's the older brother.
We'll start with Jordan.
He started playing music before me, but let Jordan start and I'll fill in any gaps.
Well, you know, I'm a 90s guy. I was a 90s kid, so I was listening to alternative and grunge rock in the 90s. Joseph and I grew up in a Christian home, so we were listening to a lot of, like, you know, whatever was kind of like modern contemporary Christian rock at the time. You know, probably quite a bit up into mid-teens for me, and then kind of transitioned over to probably what was popular in the radio. We grew up in southwestern Virginia before the internet was really popular, so what was on the radio I think is what I was hearing the most, but what was on the radio at the time was really cool. I was really into the Pumpkins and Nirvana, Rage Against the Machine, Tool, you know, all that stuff, and started playing around town with some guys who liked the same kind of music, so picked up the guitar, probably learned Hootie and the Blowfish first. It was like Hootie and the Blowfish or Today by Smashing Pumpkins. One of those things were like the first.
So drastically different, though.
Yeah, they are drastically. But at the time, they didn't feel drastically different. They were both.
Yeah.
That's alternative the thing about it. They were just both alternative rock or contemporary alternative rock or whatever. To me, they were in the same category. I like that about the 90s. I always enjoyed that. And thinking back about the 90s, I think that that's an interesting thing. That so many bands could be lumped into what alternative rock was. Hootie and the Blowfish and Tool were played on the same alternative rock station. That would obviously not really ever happen again. But yeah, that was what it was for me. And then I don't know, Joseph was Joseph was probably more adventurous than I was, and also just was listening. Joseph has always been more technologically savvy than me. So when the internet came around, Joseph discovered using it for music more quickly than me, I think. And I'll let you talk about that, because Joseph brought in a lot more, I think, music from outside of just whatever that small sphere was, the radio thing that I was hearing.
Okay. I have lots of color commentary for this. So we'll back up and say,
yeah, you do. Of course.
Our parents were huge influences, you know, with music, but not, and maybe not in the same way, because as we were born in the early 80s and started listening to music at 5 or 6 or 7 or whatever, it definitely was mostly contemporary mid 80s, early 90s Christian music. So all the big artists that I'm sure many of you podcast guests have talked about, but obviously we started with Carmen and Petra, and then DC Talk. I probably know every single lyric to 2 or 3 different DC Talk albums, and Audio Adrenaline, Deeper Cuts, Newsboys. We obviously went to a Newsboys concert.
Yeah, we went to see all those bands live too.
But the Deeper Cuts, I would say, in that genre, I really loved the release by Grammatrain. I didn't really know what grunge was, but I thought that it just sounded much more real than some of the other stuff. And then my first foray into gangster rap was the Christian gangster rap group ETW.
Tom Waters.
And there's something special. But just to add a little detail to that, obviously we were into the major label Christian stuff, and obviously we didn't get into the indie Christian stuff until later, really kind of a couple years probably before we signed to Tooth and Nail. But our parents, especially our dad, really kind of introduced us to the rock music that he grew up on, the stuff he felt comfortable letting us get into.
Yeah.
While we were listening to a lot of Christian stuff. So obviously Jordan probably can play quite a few Lynyrd Skynyrd licks, Steve Miller Band. Jordan, you can probably add a little more to this.
Oh yeah. Simple Man was the first song that I have like a conscious memory of having a conversation with my dad.
It's a great song.
Yeah. Yeah. He showed me that. Maybe I was 15. He bought me 3 CDs. Before I ever bought any CDs for myself, and they were pronounced Lynyrd Skynyrd, Allman Brothers, Ramblin' Man, and a Doobie Brothers Greatest Hits album. And in the party band that I'm in now, I bet you we play about 6 or 7 of those songs from that 3 albums. Yeah. But they were formidable for sure. Because somehow that was all just rock and roll to me. And that's what I liked. You know, whatever it was, with a guitar plugged in and loud drums, I wanted that. Lynyrd Skynyrd lived in the same sort of realm as Nirvana to me, as, you know, as I was mentioning about Hootie and Tool earlier. Somehow Skynyrd and the Allman Brothers and Doobie Brothers lived there too, even though they were 25 years apart.
Yeah.
Or whatever. They kind of lived in the same place, because they had loud guitar. And that was, for me, discovering guitar, discovering what it was, and you know, what made it sound a certain way. I jumped right into buying like every guitar player magazine that I could, because I was so interested in, you know, who was playing what guitars. And I have these memories of thumbing through and reading like the interviews with Pepper Keenan from Corrosion of Conformity, or like Kim Thal about his Guild guitars, and being like crazy interested in all those different things. Even at 15 or 16 years old, before I could afford to buy an amplifier, with whatever allowance money, you know, I could go buy a little amp with, I was always interested in that stuff, and still remain interested in that stuff. Yeah. But yeah, I'm glad you touched on all that stuff, Joseph, because my wide swath of things that I was saying wasn't really digging into the idea that we did come from, you know, a Christian home, and that really, before we ever even started playing music, we were listening to the, like, a lot of Christian rock. And Joseph will remember this. We went to a church, and probably the first sort of local concert I couldn't tell you the band's name or anything, but the church would put on gigs where they would have traveling Christian rock band. I think they called it the Rock, right? They called it the Rock. This church we went to, and they would put on these concerts for traveling, touring Christian bands, and who knows how many people would get, not ever very many people, but I remember it like this memory of going to a homecoming dance or something, and then afterwards, instead of going to party with my friends, I went to the Rock and watched it. And I wanted to, though. That's the thing. I wanted to go see that. I wanted to go watch the Rock band who...
Totally.
You know, more than I wanted to go do the other thing at the time.
Yeah. And then 15 years later, we were on like Christian tours for after we signed to Tooth & Nail, doing the same thing, playing the little venue that was attached to the...
That's so cool.
To the church.
To the back of a progressive enough church to have a band play there.
But not to go backwards, I will say, as the younger brother, I do remember Jordan and my dad were always in the choir at church, and Jordan learned to harmonize earlier than anyone I've probably ever known. And I think our parents picked up on his maybe musical ability, and he took some piano lessons. And then we were both in band in school. So we were always, I was in percussion, and Jordan played trombone and then also percussion. But yeah, just so that was really being a younger brother to a strong musician was one of my biggest influences. So as Jordan played, and he played bass for like a year or less, because he played in church before he transitioned to guitar mostly. And then, I don't know, you know this, Jeremy, from you know, going to high school in the late 90s. Local scenes were amazing. Local scenes became the thing, and regional scenes. So in our small town in Virginia, we weren't the only band, and we definitely weren't the only band in the region, but we started, you know, we'll get to this in a minute. But once Jordan started playing music, I became the biggest fan of their band, and I was a little brother, but my parents allowed me to go to the shows and help them set up, and I was like the little brother roadie. But I was also like, listened to their music, you know, went with them to record, and like was a fan of their band. And like Jordan said, we were super into contemporary rock or whatever was being played on the radio. And like one of my distinct memories from, I guess, you guys can correct the year, 98, 99, was the first time we heard Pardon Me by Incubus on the radio. That's the first time I heard the band. And I remember Jordan and I were like, we couldn't figure out if that part was the guitar player playing it on his guitar, or if it was a scratch, you know, if it was a DJ.
And
we looked up the band and we listened to Make Yourself and Science. So there was a time period when we were transitioning from obviously only growing up on Christian music and what was on the radio, but then starting to seek out this new stuff. The internet was really popular. Like Jordan said, I was a Napster kid and Kazaa, and I was like, we were seeking out, MySpace was maybe coming around. And I remember one of the very first MP3 players was a RCA. It's called the RCA Lyra, and it had a flash card that held as many songs as like one CD. It held maybe 20 songs. And I would pop that flash card out, and I would reload it every single day with my new, whatever I downloaded. It was awesome. So old, it had AA batteries. It wasn't rechargeable.
I love that.
But yeah, so incredible. Music was everything for us, you know, just from our youth and in the church and with our parents' influence and Jordan's musical ability. Yeah. And then I think I was 14 or 15 when Jordan started his first band.
And what was that band?
Esoteric.
Let me ask you this real quick before we get into that. Joseph, were you playing bass at that time too, or were you just trying? Were you hoping you could play? You know what I mean? Were you, you know, obviously looking at your brother? Yeah, that's a good question.
I was gonna say no, but I did pick up bass. But actually, when I was 14 or 15, I got a guitar for Christmas. I got like a mid-90s. Standard Strat, wish I still had it. I tried to play. It's really hard to try to learn how to play when you have an older brother that's already excellent. So I got discouraged and put it down. Didn't play it much. Kept it in the case. Probably didn't let Jordan play it. I don't think I remember letting you.
Yeah, you did. I took it and started playing it a lot.
I'm still pissed about it.
but then after I had kind of tried guitar, Jordan's band's bass player left, and I don't know how it came up, but I just like grabbed a bass and started learning a song.
You were just around. So we had this band Esoteric. It was a bunch of buddies of mine from high school, friends, majority of whom we still keep in touch with, and the drummer is one of my best buds. Still to this day, but we made a band. We started playing kind of cover songs, everything that was on the radio. And then we're like, we want to write some songs, started putting together some, you know, they were juvenile song arrangements, I guess, the simple three chord, four chord songs or whatever, but we branched out pretty quickly. I think our, Jared Unteed, our drummer, he was super into, like, you know, a lot more technical stuff. He was real into Tool and also Phish, but like playing at the time, both of those bands were kind of in the same pocket of the world, you know, playing some like Lollapalooza gigs together or whatever. And we kind of branched out pretty quickly, and started getting a little more technical with it. It was a pretty original sounding group in my opinion. Bass player left. I don't even know that we had much of a discussion about it. We were like, can Joseph learn how to play the bass? Can we teach him how to play the bass? And we were recording an EP or something with Jamie King, who we ended up recording a bunch of Far Left stuff with. We were friends with his band Swift. We had traded out some gigs and gone and opened up for their enormous crowds that they had down in Winston-Salem. We're all big fans, so we decided we wanted to go record with Jamie. And I remember, Joseph, I don't know if you played on it or not, but the last Esoteric recording that we did with Jamie. And either I played the bass and you learned it, or you learned right before we went and recorded and played the bass on it. I can't remember. You were playing like an Ibanez. I feel like you were playing like an Ibanez sound gear. Was that one that you had bought, or did you get that from the old bass player, Chris?
Oh, no. I bought it from Brian Freeman, who ended up joining Far Less later. I bought it from his boy, Bill.
Crazy.
So we were playing around a lot in town and traveling a lot with that group out of town. That was the first time that we started getting out in a driving Jared's Blazer and a trailer and probably taking PA to every gig that we could possibly book. You know, it didn't matter. We would play wherever for $75 and for enough to you know, put some gas in the car and then take the band and play for, you know, 2 hours at some super late night bar out in Roanoke or Bristol or wherever it was that we went. And then Joseph joined and we just kept playing a lot. And I guess whenever that band just naturally kind of came to an end, Joseph and I wanted to keep going.
Pretty much. So is that kind of when Far Less obviously began? Let's talk about the beginning of Far Less. Curious how the beginning was, how you kind of decided the route you wanted to go musically and maybe where the name came from.
Sure. I'll take this. Yeah. So Esoteric, as we said, we were playing out a lot. I mean, like this was every weekend, you know, as big of a region as we could do and still make it back to school, school on Monday.
Yeah, I should probably mention that really quickly. We were probably teenagers in high school or right out of high school, and Joseph was still in school in high school.
Okay.
At this moment in time, we were 18 or 19, and Joseph was like 16 or 17 years old when we're out playing like every weekend.
That's nuts.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. So that's how it was. I think I was probably 16, and Jordan maybe had just graduated right when Esoteric kind of dissolved, and we started Far Less. But basically, when Esoteric was at its peak, small town Virginia, but we're playing these regional shows, a couple hundred kids having a blast. We would play with the best, you know, the best other regional bands. And there was a band a few towns over called Purity. And that's the band that Brandon Welch, Far Less' singer, was in. They were really great at what they did in the late 90s, early 2000s. And there was a band the other direction that was even doing more experimental, weird stuff called Lessons to Reflect. Right, Jordan?
Lessons of Reflection.
And that was our drummer, Ray's first band. He was 15. He's a year younger than me. And he was a phenom. We were like, who is this kid? So Esoteric dwindled down and So did the other couple bands. And I remember I was 16. Jordan was a couple years older, right out of high school, and Ray was 15. We just went to Ray's house and started jamming. Purity was still playing. Pretty quickly, we started playing with Ray. We just took what we were doing with Esoteric and took Ray's new influence to it. Ray was a really fresh drummer. He was super into technical drumming and 311 style, kind of like a lot of snare and really quick beats and Jordan's vibe. And it just, they like clicked like that.
Yeah, we were immediately, I was immediately impressed with Ray, but his chops were kind of crazy good.
Yeah. That's awesome. So I had a friend from high school, Jake, and he joined and we started this group and put out a little EP. I think it was called the Emerge EP, and that's Jordan singing, Jake and Jordan on guitar. I play bass with Ray, and things back then happened so quickly. We're all so motivated and so much energy. We put this out. We started playing quickly with the same bands we were playing with Brandon's band Purity, with Swift, starting to do regional shows. But then Purity broke up, and it wasn't even a question. It was just like, Brandon's going to join.
We had seen Brandon. I think were we calling it the Super Team for a minute?
People were calling it the Super Team. We never actually called it ourselves that, but it was kind of a little bit of a small town. Back in the day, it was message boards before.
MySpace, called it the Super Team or whatever.
Called us the Super Team, maybe a little tongue in cheek, but Far Less from. I don't know. We've talked about this a few times, but we all had we still have a very good friend named Brian Farless. His last name was F-A-R-L-E-S-S, Farless. We were actually, Jordan and I are in, we can still say we're in another band with him. It's a comedy band called Clever. We put out a really, really great full length in. Don't laugh. I mean, it's amazing. So it was about 2000, put out a full length comedy album called Chocolate Milk on the Satellite. And Farless, I think people sometimes would call him Farless, and it was just a term that people, I don't know, when we had our little naming brainstorm. But we kind of liked the play on words because we knew it was our friend's last name. We knew we kind of like devised the story that we know we're far less than our inspirations or than the bands that precede
probably us. Something like that. Yeah, I don't know.
There's no real meaning behind it. There's definitely no
That's good to point that out. But it honestly was a play on words, I think, and it stuck.
For better or worse. I mean,
I haven't thought about that in a long time, how we came up with the name, but it is Brian Farless. That was
Brian Farless, Far Less. So obviously people joke around and say far more. I think Jeremy, you might have done that in our group text, far more. we would go to shows and far left would be on the marquee. And my friends would always call it Fart Less. So I mean
That's incredible. I love
that. But FL does work as a little bit of an acronym, graphically at work. Ray's always been a great graphic designer. So our early art and presentation from Ray doing it or other friends doing it or when we started with Tooth & Nail, obviously they had Ryan Clark to do all the graphics. So, FL leans pretty well.
But they worked. Yeah, the two letters kind of look cool absolutely. Together. And I think as many people have referred to the band as FL over the years as Far Less. I mean, I've heard FL. Our father has a FL tattoo. They make a square.
the lockup Ryan Clark did, probably, I think, with a Turn to the Bright EP. But
I want to back up really quick and just mention we were talking about Far Less starting we had this immediate connection with Ray, or I had probably an immediate connection with Ray, and Joseph and I were playing together and writing songs and all this. I had gone out and watched Brandon Welch play a couple of times with his other bands, and we had shared the stage with a few bands. And like Joseph said, I think it was when his band was breaking up or they were, whatever it was, we had some connection with Brandon and I were talking, and it was pretty much a no-brainer. It was like, I was so impressed with Brandon, his stage skills, his singing, and his, just whatever his overall presence was so impressive to me. Though I was the singer and writing the songs at the time, I was happy to pass that torch. This is the guy right here. It was a pretty easy thing. And fortunately, when we asked Brandon, he was, I think at the time, as excited as we were to have Brandon. So we did start when Far Less began for some fair amount of time as what was the core unit for quite some time was Ray and Brandon and then Joseph and myself.
Okay.
So that's kind of what we were doing for, I guess, another EP that we did with Jamie. We recorded several things with Jamie King in a row. I think four recordings in a row before we recorded with anybody else, two of which were EPs that were burned CDs that we sold. You know, you hear the stories of people selling them out of the trunks of their car. That's what we did. I mean, we had burned CDs.
Self-release. We burned them and we made nice labels and nice.
We were trying to do it the best we could without investing, a couple thousand bucks into disc makers.
Which we had done. Esoteric did a full-length release with disc makers.
We had done it before, but it was kind of one of those things where we were just trying to figure out how it was going to work and what we were going to sound like.
Absolutely.
And all that. But we did all those recordings with Jamie King, the first two EPs and then the first full-length that we did, which was Broken Hearts Unite. These are all prior to Tooth and Nail. We were not signed.
The second EP, A Possibility, when Brandon joined, I believe all or most of those songs were songs we had already written that Brandon just learned and sang.
I think so too.
But then as soon as he joined, we started writing Broken Hearts Unite. So all the melodies and lyrics on Broken Hearts Unite, except two songs that were also on A Possibility, made it to Broken Hearts Unite, I think, one or two.
That's right. Those were all, for the most part, Brandon.
Brandon
came up with those melodies and the screaming. He introduced that to the band. I had not been doing that. I maybe did, you know, kind of like a half-ass scream, you know, trying to emulate somebody that, you know, Zach De La Roca or Gary from Swift. We were all big Swift fans. Salem, a heavy metal or like kind of newish heavy metal band. And we were all big fans. We played gigs with them. Jamie King was the drummer. And so we were all big fans of them. And the guy's scream was bananas good. And they were so good live. So if I was doing it, it was kind of like probably trying to rip somebody off. I don't even think I screamed on any of the recordings, but then Brandon came in and did some of that stuff. And it was really genuine and effective and seemed more real. It's, you know, he had his own sound, his own thing.
Yeah. Well, Brandon and Ray really clicked because they had listened to, they had a lot of heavier influences than Jordan and I. And then Ray was, he was younger and he was seeking out a lot of new music. So he was the one that would bring us kind of the newer.
Okay.
I mean, he's the first person who ever showed us Beloved, you know, and he was seeking out some of the newer hardcore metalcore metal stuff, Chasing Drum, you know, or Dillinger Escape Plan and stuff like that. And then Brandon had a connection, a little deeper connection to 90s heavy music. I mean, he listened to Pantera more than us. Obviously, the Pumpkins were his favorite band, but we were compared to some other Tooth and Nail bands. Like we definitely had a contemporary vibe and some connection to the new metal scene of the late 90s. Like we weren't a new metal band, but new metal fans liked us. So we would go play with a lot of regional bands that we weren't really calling it new metal at the time. We were just calling it rock, right?
Yeah, totally.
And sometimes the difference between a good rock band in the 90s and a new metal band was like how baggy their pants were or how depressed their lyrics were. You know what I mean?
Musically it was somewhat similar. I did buy a 7-string guitar at some point, whether it was Far Less or Esoteric. I did, but had a short period of time where I listened to Korn, you know, quite a bit, or Stain or whatever that was.
Finger 11 was like my favorite band. I mean,
right. But then like we're talking about toting the line, Finger 11, you know, though they were probably lumped into the same thing, feels different to me, completely different than Korn or whatever.
But then you watch a video and one of their guitar players looked like he was in Korn, but the singer looked. Yeah. So,
yeah, sure.
And that's just like if I had one takeaway from Far Less is we always kind of like we never specifically wanted to be part of a certain scene.
Sure.
That's true.
We're like that kid in school who just was friends with everybody. We weren't necessarily the jocks or the nerds or whatever, or, you know, the SCA president. We were just buddies with everybody. We would play shows with our friends. And like right at this time, Broken Hearts Unite, we were playing with our friends Couch Boy. They were a punk, local punk band. We were playing with Swift, and they were a new metal slash metal band. And
I'm a porn star that's not like Propaganda or Anti-Flag or something like that.
Yeah, we're playing. Yeah, so and generally we would fit in with any of these groups or shows. We started fitting in less. We became friends, you know, in indie band. When we moved to Blacksburg, indie is its own thing. College is its own thing. And we were friends with those guys and we would play with them. And depending on the scene, you know, sometimes we weren't accepted so much by the more pretentious college indie kids. But sometimes we were and sometimes, you know what I mean?
And, yeah, no, I get it.
And that was a tricky spot musically because we liked to listen to anything and we would just write whatever, experimenting with gear. We weren't chasing a super hardcore tone or vibe. We were just playing what we liked. And if it had double bass, it made sense and we liked it. If it didn't and it was singing, we would do. I mean, actually, Broken Hearts Unite, although it is, I don't know what you consider it, a emo core.
Yeah, something like that, probably.
Hardcore, you know, rock.
If anybody's familiar with it, that's probably what they would think.
Yeah, but it don't, you know, it's got 11 or 12 songs, but I think only four of them have any screaming.
Like
melody based music.
I think we're trying to for the most part. And when we're making Broken Hearts Unite, I think we're still trying to figure it out. I think we're always trying to figure it out. But I think if you look at Far Less from day one in the late 90s or early 2000s through the next 10 years of us doing it actively, I think the whole entire time we're continuously figuring it out. And when I say that, I mean it in a good and a positive way. I think I'm still at 42 years old creating original music, still trying to figure it out. So I'm not saying that we never landed on anything. We landed on things through different periods of what we were digesting and what we were taking in. And I, you know,
all albums really sound the same.
Not really. Not particularly. So we did this, but maybe to back up, we did this. Broken Hearts Unite was the first full-length record and the first thing that we did that Brandon Welch had a pretty heavy influence on the writing. Then we released that with a small label. At the time, it was the first release, Silent Uproar Records. Raleigh and Charlotte, I guess Grant Henry probably introduced us. He was in a band that liked and played a lot with, a band called Mini Void from Asheville. They were super badass. We were all huge fans of Mini Void. Grant from Mini Void has gone on to play. He's the Metroid metal guy. If you ever get into like the super nerdy comic book and game con scene, this guy's like a god in that scene, I think, in a lot of ways. Awesome. He takes all the Metroid music and makes it heavy metal and then does his own called Stimage. Writes music for video game scoring and all this other stuff.
Oh, that's awesome.
He introduced us to his friends who were kind of actively trying to do a record label. And we met Scott Harkey and Robbie Player, immediately had a connection with those guys. You know, they had a little money to sink into helping us out and some connections that we didn't have.
Yeah.
And they went on to release several more records after, the
Broken Hearts Unite. This was 2003. That I think Broken Hearts Unite came out in 2003. And the rest of us had moved to Blacksburg. I was a freshman at Virginia Tech. And Jordan was at Radford. And Brandon lived in Pulaski, which is close by. So this was like during the week, we were driving to our parents' house in halfway. And Ray was meeting us to practice. And we wrote this record like, you know, like now it's very common for bands to live in different towns and cities and work through the internet and write stuff. And we lived in different towns and cities and we just drove twice a week to the most central location and jammed. And, I mean, I remember we did a tour, our first like tour. Obviously we played plenty of long weekends, but we did a winter tour. I think the winter of 2003, 2004?
Something like that. Yeah.
Gold Star. And they're a North Carolina, kind of just pop rock band, really good friends with those guys. And Ray would have to go home in between shows. It was like a regional tour and he would drive back home for high school.
Wow.
Drove his little Civic out there or whatever and played the gig. And then he put his drums back in his car, drive to school the next day, and then leave immediately and meet us out
insane.
In Fayetteville, North Carolina, or wherever it was.
We had his gig.
Or, you know, Richmond or whatever. You know, I don't remember where we played, but he would do that and go back to school.
Crazy.
And then Ray got into Virginia. He, he was accepted to Virginia Tech. So he was living up there for the next little bit with Joseph after, when they were at school. This is prior, still all this is prior to signing with Tooth and Nail.
Speaking of Tooth and Nail, let's get to that. How does Tooth and Nail come into the picture? Was there any other labels and maybe vying for your attention as well? And what made you decide on Tooth and Nail?
Everybody remembers things differently. So Joseph, correct me if I'm wrong in my full assessment here, but I liked Tooth and Nail. We didn't grow up listening to the real old school Tooth and Nail stuff. So it's like I wasn't listening to MXPX or Grody Hook or whatever, like at the time, when we were teenagers or whatever that is. But I remember going and living in Blacksburg and going to the Ton 80 Club and knowing about Tooth and Nail Records. We were actively seeking out independent record labels. We thought that made more sense. We had a local following, but we didn't have a big manager or a big booking agency. And we hadn't, so we didn't really know how to approach it. And to us, it made more sense to seek out an independent record label. And I remember going and watching May. It was like really early on for May. They were, I think playing Destination Beautiful.
I'll tell you, this is after they had signed to Tooth and Nail, but before Destination Beautiful had been released.
So this is this is like that time.
Pretty early. At a 50 capacity bar in Blacksburg.
Yeah, like a dark bar. They were playing upstairs at it.
Yeah, Jeremy, you can help me out here, but this is what I would have called something like the Tooth and Nail 2.0, like the heyday of Tooth and Nail, right? When Solid State and Tooth and Nail were just popping out bangers.
And
we were playing heavy stuff, but we loved melody. So we're looking at Tooth and Nail and we're looking at Solid State and seeing Norma Jean and Beloved, and looking at Tooth and Nail and seeing Me Without You and Under Oath and just seeing. There was also so much touring back then, and so much good. The tours were huge. And
yeah, and Blacksburg was the town people came to. It was a college town.
Yeah, so yeah, we would still jump down to North Carolina and see some tours come through, and it's. The segue is really simple. We became really close with the guys that ran Silent Uproar, Scott and Robbie, and they only wanted the best for us, right?
Sure.
And Scott went to CMJ in New York. CMJ, whatever you call it, artist.
Yeah, the festival. Yeah.
Festival, yeah. In like 2003, CMJ, and he handed Broken Hearts Unite to John Frazier.
That's exactly what it was. They had a Tooth and Nail, like a showcase or whatever. Handed off the record to John.
Wow.
And I do not know if Scott gave it to anyone else. He may have given out 100 copies. But I mean, like within a week or two of CMJ, we were talking to John.
Yeah, somebody got John's like AIM handle or whatever and handed it over to me. Maybe Scott gave it to me or whatever. And I think I hit John up probably straight up cold call, like, hey, man, this is Jordan from the band Far Less. I know that our friend Scott gave you a CD, yada, yada, yada. And John was immediately friendly and receptive. And, John's a Virginia guy. We're Virginia guys. So there was that connection. John was living in Seattle at the time. John Frazier from Tooth and Nail, who ended up being our A&R guy there. He was living in Seattle. But we were just chatting daily. And I think he was intrigued enough with what he had heard to and probably also kind of wanted to consider, helping a band from Virginia out. Virginia guy. May was one of his first groups at Tooth and Nail. I think he probably brought May to Tooth and Nail.
They did.
We connected about those kinds of things. And John and I talked a lot. I don't know. I'm assuming you probably also were chiming in on those conversations too, Joseph. At the time, I was probably kind of the band's business manager to some degree, handling a lot of this stuff. There were feelers and there were other things, but Tooth and Nail was honestly the first record label to actually pay us enough attention to have a what we consider to be a meaningful conversation.
Sure.
So we kept talking to John. He wanted to hear more songs. We started probably demoing some more songs, and we had an opportunity to, and Joseph, you're going to have to be more clear with about this. I don't know which came first. Were we signed to Tooth and Nail when we played the CMJ Fest, the showcase?
Yeah, we were already on Tooth and Nail when that happened.
Okay, so
we had not signed yet. We had not signed a Tooth and Nail yet when we played Cornerstone. we were quote unquote negotiating, I think.
Well, yeah, we maybe had some kind of like soft deal on the plate or
sure
or something like that. And John asked us if we would come up and play. I honestly think somebody had dropped off. There was a pretty last minute thing. Somebody had dropped off Cornerstone Fest and there was an opening and they asked
That's CMJ. That's how we ended up playing CMJ.
Well, either way, we did go up and play Cornerstone Fest. We were friends with He Is Legend already. We had played some shows with them. We were friends with Haste the Day already. I think that we had played a gig with Joseph and I were talking a little bit about this yesterday. We had played a gig somewhere with Haste the Day and the singer Jimmy was like extremely cool. And the He Is Legend guys great too. Guy. They were all extremely cool and wanted to be helpful, and I think they all liked the band. We hit it off and on a personal level also with those bands. And so I think they all wanted to be very helpful. So John was hearing it from bands too, you know.
Totally.
You know, we're talking to John, and then these other guys are
confirming
reaching out on our behalf, which was very kind of them, and still really appreciate them doing that. So we go up and play Cornerstone Fest. That was probably the first time we ever played for anyone at the record label. It was probably the first time we actually met John. Is that the first time we met John that you can remember, Joseph?
Yeah, I don't remember meeting John at Cornerstone. I remember meeting Chad.
Well, I know Chad was there. I thought John was too.
I want to step back because it may not seem like much, but it's just a memory that will stick in my head forever. We played with Haste today because they were on tour and had an off day in Greensboro. And we were playing, we would always play Greensboro. We had so many friends and we were living in Blacksburg, but coming down to Greensboro to play with The Necessary and Bludgeon and like all the great, North Carolina bands. So we were playing a show, I believe it was at the Somewhere Else Tavern in Greensboro on a Saturday, one of those seven band bills. But back then, the whole scene showed up, you know, it was like just so many kids there, and Haste Today had an off day and they came to the show and they were just hanging out in their van and we were headlining.
They were friends with He Is Legend, right? Is that how it was? We were playing with He Is Legend. Yeah, I think they were too.
Okay. Either way, they just asked if they could like just play as like a surprise set. And I remember playing our set and seeing the guys in Haste Today watch us. And then they hopped up and borrowed some of our gear and just absolutely killed it. It was so awesome. And we just became like friends. I don't think we exchanged phone numbers or anything, but maybe like screen names or something. And I remember we showed up at Cornerstone and played a kind of early set, but it was a reasonable crowd. And here comes Jimmy out of nowhere and just stood up front and watched us. So he was, you know, we didn't keep in touch forever, but you know, that's right. The time when Jimmy moved to Seattle and started working for Tooth & Nail somewhere around then. So he knew it. He knew them so well, and he put in a good word for us. And
that's cool.
And like he didn't have to. And we weren't a hardcore band at all. We were just a rock band.
Yeah.
And he put in a good word for us. And that's right. That's it. We didn't seek attention from anyone else. We were really liking the bands that Tooth & Nail and Solid State had, and we saw it as an opportunity in front of us. And to step back, we were like super stoked with Silent Uproar. Like we were college kids in a rock band, and we had this label that put our stuff out, and we weren't really actively, we were starting to think what might be next, but we were 18, 19, 20, you know, like this, it was a kind of a surprise when Scott was like, this guy from Tooth & Nail, you should hit him up. I gave him your CD.
That's awesome.
And it just all kind of just happened very quickly. I mean, we played Cornerstone that summer, probably the summer of 2003, I think, after Broken Hearts Unite came out. And within weeks it's been a long time, but it's 20 years now. Within weeks, we worked out the details.
Stay tuned for part two. Thanks for listening.